Welcome, everybody, to another awesome episode of Wellness Warriors. Today, I've got a fellow Canadian, Dr. Marisol Teijeiro. She's known as the Queen of Thrones. No, not Game of Thrones, but Queen of Thrones because of her passion for cleansing and healing gut health. Marisol is a naturopath. She's been a naturopath for over 15 years. She's trained doctors and thousands of patients to transition from IBS to owning their throne and thriving. She's written a book called O-S-H-I-T, and she's got all kinds of programs that has helped thousands of people. Now, I learned an interesting fact. 14% of the world's population have bowel problems. That's a billion people in the world. So you've got a very large market, my dear.
I do. And you know, that's just the amount of people that have reported having problems with their bowels, which is just, you know, staggering if you really consider it, because a lot of people just think it's normal to not have healthy stools, right?
Right. So I remember growing up, if I had a bowel movement once a week, it was a good thing. You know, I mean, when we grow up on canned food and white bread and sugar and, you know, you're indoors in the wintertime. I mean, it's just, I don't know how I survived, but I did a lot of colon cleansing as I got older. So tell me why gut health? Why poop? Why did that become your passion?
Exact same as you. You know, I was growing up in Northern Ontario, Canada, you know, cold winters, fresh produce we would get from the stores, but it wasn't as abundant in the summertime. And my mother was chronically constipated, and so was I. And it's just interesting our histories because, you know, like my mother had breast cancer. She was my first breast cancer patient. You know, constipation is such a major deal and a major problem. All my patients with breast cancer, same deal. They all have issues with their bowels, constipation or what have you. So for me, it started when I was younger, seeing my mother struggling. At first, I actually just thought it was normal because that's what my mother would do. And then I realized that it wasn't normal to go every 3 days, every week. That wasn't normal, right? Like sitting there waiting, praying a little bit would come out. It was really just horrible. And as I got older, it got worse and I started having alternations. So I'd either be constipated or I'd go into diarrhea. And that was the whole stress being imposed over top of normal life, right? And I did so many different things to try to get it better. I was, you know, going to health food stores, asking for help. They were recommending weird things like castor oil packs, or, you know, I'd take the different supplements they would tell me to do. But I really wasn't ever getting better. I wouldn't do the weird things, but I would do the supplements because they were easy to do. So I felt like I was taking all the right supplements. I was seeing all the right doctors. I was doing all the right exercises, and things weren't ever getting better. And so then, you know, finally I decided I'm going back to naturopathic school because this is really impacting my life. It would, number one, I would be scared to go out in public, and I'm a very social person. I'd be worried, like, where's the bathroom? Am I going to have an accident? I would be carrying spare pairs of underwear. Like, no lie, this is how I was living. So I got really fed up, and I went to school, and in naturopathic school there, you know, I started continuing to like learn and curate the best things for the gut and gut health. And then I got really sick. And that's where things really, really changed for me. And where that, you know, weird thing that people were prescribing, you know, at the very beginning of my problems, you know, back when I was 20, you know, that castor oil pack, I finally decided to do it. And then I realized that everything that I was doing was working better with that castor oil pack as a foundation. So then I just, you know, spearheaded what moved forward and just decided, like, to me, the health of the body is reliant on the health of the digestive tract and of the gut. I was just in New York City, and we stopped by Grand Central Station. And I, you know, looking at Grand Central Station, you just realize how majestic that station is and how it is the hub of everything that goes in and out of that city. And that is the gut. You know, if you're talking about hormones, there's more hormones in the gut than there is in the rest of the body. If you're talking about neurotransmitters, dopamine, melatonin, there's 10 times more melatonin in the gut than there is in the brain for sleep. You know, and melatonin is so important for women with breast cancer or any type of hormonal cancers, you know, so it's just this hub that really is a center that regulates all of the regulatory systems of the body. And without the help of the gut, we can't actually have health. And the biggest amazing thing about the gut is that it creates our number one product, which is our stools. And our stools let us see. They're like little love letters that tell us what we need to know and what we should be doing in order to get better balance and always be working towards having those, you know, perfect poos, or what I call royal flushes, which are, you know, a perfect specimen of poo. But we never really achieve perfection in life or in health. It's always a journey, but we're always striving for that, right? So it's just super interesting. And I'm just in love with the gut because, you know, ironically, in clinical practice, what I practice mostly and what I see mostly is actually a lot of cancer patients and a lot of autoimmune patients. But I believe it's this. It's because if you can treat those hardest conditions, they all stem from the same problem. It's all the gut. Like the gut is the core of it. And then, of course, you know, inflammation is a problem. Microbiome is a problem. All these other, you know, cofactors are there. But it's all in the gut, right? So I can treat the hardest of the hard, and I can treat the simplest of the simplest, but I see mostly cancer patients and mostly autoimmune conditions, right? So it's but because the focus is on the gut.
Yeah. I remember I was very young in practice, you know, the early 1980s, and I read Dr. Bernard Jensen's book, you know, about colon cleansing, and then Irons. I mean, he was back in the 60s and 70s, way ahead of his time. I really had a fascination with cleansing my colon, and I did, you know, colonics, and I bought a Kalima board, and I did, you know, the bentonite clay and the psyllium husk. You know, I did all that for many, many years. And so I totally understand. I mean, there are over 28 toxic chemicals that are recirculated in the body when you have a constipated gut.
Yeah.
So we know it's a serious problem. So, you know, we hear the word biofilm a lot. What is the biofilm in our gut?
Yeah. So biofilm is what I like to say. It's like that we have all these bacteria, trillions of bacteria within our gut, our mucous membrane, and all over our skin. And these bacteria, they start to form colonies and families, basically extended families. In these families, they need to create a home. And so what they do is they create like a barrier, walls that protect them. And that is in essence a biofilm. So it's basically a mixture of matrices and its different proteins and mucus that basically keeps the bacteria stuck up against the mucosal membrane wall. So it protects it from being attacked by, you know, antimicrobials. It protects it from, you know, being destroyed, and it allows them to propagate and get really big. And so to have these really, really big extended families. But biofilm, the problem with it is it's very tough to get rid of. And there aren't very many natural tools that actually reduce biofilm. And, you know, one of the better tools that you can look at in conventional medicine is antibiotics. But the problem with antibiotics is that biofilm takes a long time to grow and is long standing, but antibiotics works on things that grow quickly and grow fast and multiplicate fast. So they're good at killing off the bacteria, but the antibiotics are not so great at getting rid of the biofilm. So that's one of the reasons why when you do take antibiotics, you will destroy some of your gut bacteria, but not all of it, because there'll be a portion of the bacteria that will be protected by the biofilm. So it's really, really important, and especially in the most chronic of conditions, to work on the biofilm instead of just the bacteria. And most people are simply just taking probiotics in order to like replenish their bacteria, but it's not doing anything for the biofilm. And really what you have to get to is you have to work on breaking down the biofilm, then you can reset and repopulate with a healthy gut bacteria. And that's the idea, because truly you can do it, but it would take a long time simply just with diet. Right?
So how does one know if their biofilm is healthy or unhealthy, and how do you fix that problem?
Great. Well, one way that we look at is we look at the stools. And I always, the biggest number one question I ask to all my patients in clinic is this: are you a hyper wiper? And it's a simple question. Everyone looks at me like I'm a crazy lady when I say that. But it goes back to like the principles, the simplest of simplest things is that if you look at your dog as an example, when the dog goes to the bathroom and they're healthy, they go to the bathroom and they squat, they pop out their poo, and they walk away. You don't go wiping their bum. You know, humans, here we are, we wipe once, wipe twice, wipe three times, wipe four times, still there's more coming onto the paper. That's a sign that our stools are very full of mucus, they're very moist, there's probably inflammation in the dietary tract, more than likely there's biofilm problems and an overgrowth or abundance of bad bacteria. Otherwise, the stools would be much more tighter and much more concentrated. So that's one of the best signs that you can see from your stools, and something that's so easy to address, right? Because you can look at it, you can see it, and you can be like, okay, I've got problems. Either the foods that I'm eating in the past 24 to 48 hours are really allergic to me, or if it's constant, then I definitely have problems with my bacteria and my gut because it's just a constant problem. And then, you know, there's more than just hyper wiping too. There's the smell that can indicate bad bacteria. There's also things like transit time. So how long the food takes from going into the mouth to coming out your bum. Is there an issue with your bacteria? So the longer the transit time, that will also indicate problems with your biofilm and problems with bacteria too.
So when somebody eats nuts and seeds, so they should see some undigested nuts and seeds within 18 hours, 12 hours?
Yeah, usually around 24 hours would be the absolute ideal.
Okay.
The actual statistics are horrible for women. For men, it's 1.7 is the average. So from the time that they eat it, 1.7 days. And for women, it's 2.5. That's the average.
Wow. Yeah.
But remember, right? Studies, you need to look at the study, the methodology, you know, how they're being done. You know, these people aren't people who are eating a healthy, you know, Véronique Desaunier diet, you know, or a Dr. Marisol Queen of the Thrones diet. You know, they're eating the standard sad American diet, right? So it's that kind of shows you what the average is out there in the world. And this is one of the reasons why many conventional doctors have often said to their patients, you know, when they're going every 3 days, like I was often told, oh, you're going every 3 days, no problem. Just some people have slower bowels, right? Slower bowel movements, but it's not true. It should be daily is the ideal. And it's dependent upon the types of foods you eat, the health of the bacteria within your gut, the inflammation in your gut, the food sensitivities, your lack of antioxidants or not, and then stress as a mechanism that impacts your hormones, your nervous system, your immune system, right? So those are all the factors that deal with your microbiome and you having a good and healthy biofilm.
Right. So one of your specialties, other than poop, is also the use of castor oil. Now, castor oil was, you know, kind of an old wives remedy, you know, that has been used for many, many years. And it's definitely, we're seeing a resurgence of it. And I remember doing castor oil packs during my first healing journey. Awesome. So tell us, you know, why castor oil and why, you know, why you're so excited about it.
What I found is, you know, I worked for so long in the natural health industry, and I was really fortunate to get such amazing training with the best doctors in Germany. And, you know, so my background has been really extensive, and I've been honestly so fortunate, Véronique. And what I realized was that even those advanced doctors in Germany, like they were using all of the old school methodologies, but what they would do is that they would take these old school methodologies and they would superimpose the advanced treatment strategies. And that's where I would see amazing results. And so when I got into practice, I had gotten really sick in naturopathic school. And what had happened was that at that time I was taking all the things I was supposed to be taking. I was doing all the advanced naturopathic therapeutics, but I was still sick. And the reason was that my terrain wasn't being addressed. And what castor oil packs deal with is they deal with the terrain. Now, terrain is an old name for looking at the environment or the whole ecology of the body. You know, we have focused a lot of us in our modern day science just on the bacteria or the bug, just like the old scientific research, like Louis Pasteur, who invented, you know, the germ theory. But Louis Pasteur, on his deathbed, he mentioned something very important. You know, he gave credit to Bernard, who was the other French scientist who worked on terrains and not the bugs. And he said, it's not about the bug, it's about the terrain. This is Pasteur recanting on his deathbed.
Right.
This is well known, right? And so this is the thing, was that here I was doing all the things to address the bugs in my body, to address antioxidant status. I was doing all those things, but I wasn't doing anything to address my terrain. And there's 5 true pillars in your terrain that need to be addressed simultaneously in order to have really good benefit from all the treatments that you're doing. And those 5 pillars are super simple. Number one, you have to have really effective function of your digestion, how you absorb and how you eliminate. eat. Without that, your body becomes bottlenecked. You are recirculating toxins. You can't absorb good antioxidants. You just have a plethora of problems from there. And of course, you know, not going to the bathroom is stressful for any system. Then number two is antioxidant status. We have to have great status in terms of things like glutathione, very important, you know, in so many different treatments and cancer patients, B vitamins, all these things are super important, you know, making sure there's a good base of antioxidants, nitric oxide, etc. Number three, we have to have inflammation in control. We don't want to inhibit inflammation because inflammation is healing, but we want a little bit of it to heal, but not too much of it, because then it becomes destructive if there's too much. And then fourth, we need to have really good parasympathetic tone. And this is the area where most of our treatments kind of falter, because you actually need to do either a physical therapy, like go for a massage, do an acupuncture, you know, taking things like GABA and magnesium and those like neurocalming agents isn't sufficient. You actually need to have, you know, treatment on the body. And this is where my feelings is that castor oil packs excel. Because whenever you do a castor oil pack, you place it on your body. A castor oil pack is simply just, you know, a cotton flannel that you take, you basically pour two tablespoons of oil. These are my awesome easy packs. And you blot it and you place it on your liver. So just basically underneath of your right rib cage. But when you place this castor oil pack on your body, you're stimulating so many of the nerve receptors on the skin, the C-tactile receptors, Merkel receptors, all these receptors that deal with soft, pleasant touch, but also sustained pressure. And what this does is this feedback straight into your parasympathetic system, which is the opposite of the stress state, which is the sympathetic. We want people to be in the parasympathetic. And so it starts to train your body. The more you practice these castor oil packs, it trains your body to get into that relaxed state. In the example of, say, women who have breast cancer, you know, one of the classic things that is noted with them is that they have real problems with their circadian rhythm, right? And at night, their sleep is always disastrous. Every single breast cancer patient I've ever had, I have not had one who ever slept properly, right?
It is
like classic. And the other thing what's really interesting is that also correlates to the research with melatonin, how melatonin helps with all these hormonal cancers. But it makes sense because the circadian rhythm is so strung out. And so where castor oil packs, you know, have really benefited people is that they help you to poop better, sleep better, cleanse better, bloat less, stress less, and hormonally balance better. So then you're really targeting all the things that are the base that will get your system regulated, including your microbiome and breaking down that biofilm as well too. So it's a terrain medicine that is really creating the supportive pillars for the food to work better, the supplements you're taking to work better, the treatments you're doing to work better, for everything to work better. So that's why for me, they become my passion and my saving grace. I do them every night. First thing I pack, like it's coming with me no matter what.
So what's the active ingredient, rhinoleic acid in castor oil?
Exactly. It's ricinoleic acid. And castor oil is a vegetable oil, and it actually contains ricinoleic acid, also contains olive oil components and linoleic, which is sunflower. So you've got omega-6s and omega-9s in there, which is great. So you're getting a variety of essential fats. And then this ricinoleic acid, the molecular structure actually looks very similar to prostaglandins. So that's the end result of what you get when you take fish oils. Mm-hmm. So for our women patients as well too, how we adapt this is that many of them have problems with digesting and absorbing fats orally, because so many of them have had their gallbladder removed or they have problems with their gallbladder. But when they adopt these castor oil packs, it's a way for them to get a daily dose of good oils as well, without having the impeding doom of the uncomfortable symptoms of having too much fat in their diet. So then this castor oil can be topically a substitute for a fish oil if people have problems with taking fish oils, because it's providing those prostaglandins. And those prostaglandins are really effective to get the smooth muscle in the body to move, which means peristalsis, so you'll have good bowel movements. But then there's just so many actions within that. It's not only that. take prostaglandins, but castor oil also stimulates in the gut nitric oxide and in the body. Mm-hmm. And nitric oxide is incredible at bringing circulation to the area, right? So cancer exists typically in a high state of sugar, a high state of inflammation, and oftentimes in a non-oxygenated state, right? So there's lack of blood flow. So what you want to do is you want to bring blood flow to all the extremities of the air of the body and everywhere in the body, and having more nitric oxide in the system that helps to do that. So it's pretty miraculous, all the different things it does.
So women with breast cancer, can they do castor oil packs on their breast tissue?
100%. Yeah. We still have our patients with breast cancer do castor oil packs on their breast, but also on the liver. Right. And we have them do that alternating nights. And we actually do one little, when we take it one step above when it comes to the breast cancer treatments, is that we actually steam a cabbage leaf. So we'll take the castor oil pack, we'll put a cabbage leaf, and we'll put the castor oil directly onto the breast, and then we'll place it on the breast. Sometimes they'll even just use their bras and place the cabbage leaf, the castor oil on the breast, and then the cabbage leaf. And we're just trying to get those SGSs into the body, whether they're absorbing through the cabbage leaf and the oil, we're not 100% sure. There's no exact research to that. But, you know, we've had a lot of benefit in terms of mastitis and that helping there. So we don't see why it's bothersome to try it with our cancer patients. So we actually do that with all our cancer patients across the board.
Cabbage. So they put castor oil, then the cabbage leaf?
Yep, exactly. And then they can use an old bra if they want, and then they can do their castor oil pack over their liver. But they're doing the castor oil on the breast directly. And some won't want to use their bra, so those patients will use the castor oil pack directly on the breast. But it's a great little recipe. And you know, my mother was my first cancer patient, and her nipple was pretty severely, like, she was very shy about showing her breasts. And imagine this, two daughters, and she never told any of us that her nipple was bleeding, and, you know, it was cauliflower. Like, it was really, like, you could tell that something was very, very wrong. And, you know, like immediately, like, thankfully, we were able to do surgery with her breast because the cancer had spread too far. But what we were doing in the initial stages before they gave her a go for surgery was that we were doing this castor oil directly on top of the breast and with the cabbage leaf. And it was giving her a lot of relief as well too. And I've had other patients with the same situation where, you know, they have bleeding from the nipple or the mass is really protruding, and doing these really reduces less pain. Castor oil also modulates pain sensation as well, and then reduces the inflammation. And right away, when you reduce inflammation around a cancer mass, then that is helping to reduce what's creating more growth in the cancer.
Right. Well, that's good. That's good to know. All right. So you have a gift for us.
Yeah, we sure do. So what we're doing for the next, I believe it's 10 days, we're going to be providing people with, they have the option to get our castor oil pack bundle. So you get the bundle, which gives you the castor oil pack with the oil, but you'll also get the Odithrone, which is our all natural, organic, after you poop parfum. So you spray it in the toilet after you go. Make sure you always want to look at your stools because it'll give you valuable information, but you spray it after you go. And, you know, we really find it important to spray after you go because this is another interesting fact about stool. 30 to 50% of our stool is made up of bacteria. So if you imagine, if you go to the bathroom, if you drop a big one and then you flush the toilet, and most people don't close the lid, a lot of that bacteria is going all over the bathroom. So just spray after you go. So then that way you protect yourself and others from getting bacteria, because you don't know whether you're spreading the good bacteria or the bad bacteria, but you're spreading that. So spray after you go. These herbs in this formula not only are good for your gut and to calm your body down, but they're also nice and disinfecting as well too. So it's a great little treat. It's a $20 value. So people will get that for free.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah.
Buy the castor oil pack bundle and get the Odithrone for free.
For free. That's great. And then you also had a book, an ebook, 50 Shades of Poo.
Yeah. Our 50 Shades of Poo are, yeah. So 50 Shades of Poo is excellent. It gives you, it's the first step in the journey about understanding about your stools. And when you take this step in understanding your stools, you can, you know, number one, look at the color. And then you know, from this interview, listen to the, what your wipe is doing. And then you can evolve from there in understanding, because there's actually 11 measures that dictates a healthy stool. And so, you know, your goal eventually is to learn all 11, and from those 11, then to apply them in, you know, your daily life. Like, maybe I need to work on my gut. Maybe I have too much estrogen in my body. You know, I'm constipated. That's a sign of excess estrogen. All these little nuggets and clues that you can get in your stools.
So it's awesome. Yeah. Great to know. So where can people find you, Marisol?
Absolutely. So find me online, www.drmarisol.com, or on Instagram. We're very active on Instagram and Facebook at Dr. Marisol at Queen of the Thrones. And I would love to see everyone there.
Okay. This has been very enlightening. Enjoyed it. And thanks for sharing your information with our audience. I know they'll love it.
You're so welcome, Edinick. My pleasure.
Thanks for all you do.
Thank you.
All right, this is Dr. V. Till next time, sending you a big healing heart hug. Bye for now.